For 25 years now, I've been a globe-trotting photographer, I guess, for National Geographic. And most of the time when we do a Q&A session, the number one question we get is, you know, have you ever come close to getting killed on assignment? One lady asked me if I ever had been killed on assignment yet, and I said, no, not quite. But, you know, for the job, we try to do a lot of research, and we try to not take unnecessary risks, but still, you get the Chevy van that won't start for an hour, and the polar bear trying to peel the doors open, and it's kind of nerve-wracking. The only thing I've been bitten by, though, are bugs. Lots and lots of bugs over the years. You're looking at the feet of a very nervous photographer who hadn't made a picture in 3 days, and that's enough to warrant me taking my shoes and socks off for a half hour. The nice thing is that the director of photography at the time, when he saw this in the magazine, he sent me a coupon for a free pedicure, which was very generous of him, you know. So, you know, as I've gone along, most of the time through my career, I've been a field photographer, and that means going out and seeing the world and bringing the readership back what I've seen. I've seen the legacy of mining, you know, to its just good and bad, I guess, and extraction of fossil fuels off the ocean floor when that goes wrong. And we all burn fossil fuel to get here, and so it's just something that we kind of put up with. I thought for sure when that pipe broke off at the bottom of the floor in the Gulf of Mexico, we would change a little bit, but we're drilling back there as hard as we can still, you know, and there's a consequence to every action, I guess. And logging, as we see the world's forests going away, that's going to have real serious implications for all of us, because rainfall is not going to come where it did. It's going to come in too great an amount or too little. We're going to see dire consequences if we take out all our rainforests and replace it with farming. So these are all things that I've seen firsthand. I live in Lincoln, Nebraska, where we have this now. And you know, it's the monarchs that I showed you at the top of the show, I mean, they're drastically impacted by this. And they're just monarchs, you say. Well, they're beautiful and they diminish our world, I think, when they go away. We haven't left any room for them. We just plant corn and beans and rotate them. The elephant in the room, it's us. It's all of us, you know. I have 3 children. We're on our way to 10 billion. Are we gonna consume the entire surface of the earth? Or will we be smart enough to save back tracts of habitat that will stabilize our climate and allow us to live? That's the big question. It's big. How do we illustrate that, though? This is kind of complicated stuff. How do we illustrate that for a populace that seems to be getting more and more shallow in a way, in terms of just being really, really focused on things that might seem trivial to many of us? Kim Kardashian's rear end, for example. How do we really convey what's going on the ground? Well, this is in Northern Australia. Where are the koalas going to live? Well, they live on the ninth fairway. I was kind of shocked when I went over there. You see this. Koalas try to move around. They try to come out of off the golf course. They get hit by cars or bitten by dogs. This is a picture that actually moved the needle a little bit. 1 week's worth of koalas all killed by dogs out of the freezer at one vet lab. The nurses there saved them for me until I could get over there. 1 week's worth, because they were outraged. And after this picture ran, what do you know? The government of Australia, this thing ran around the world. Not long after, they passed a law that offered some protection to the northern koala, which was nice. I can't say this picture did that, but didn't hurt. What else can we do, though, to turn things around besides just expose bad things? We can highlight good things. That's a great thing. These guys that used to cut the forest down, they helped take me in to see the mountain gorillas. If you want to save mountain gorillas, go see them. Ecotourism brings money to the site. It brings real dollars to local people. Same with lions. If you love lions, go see them. Ecotourism brings money to local communities. Where there's national park on the right, everything else outside the national park is developed, is farmed. You know, these guys that push cattle into the park, these cattlemen, used to be they'd poison carcasses to kill the lions. Well, now thanks to this veterinarian over there, they're all being hired as guides. Go see the lions if you want to see the lions. In our capitalistic world, things that pay, stay. Pretty simple concept, isn't it? Pretty simple. Well, so as I said, you know, I've been traveling around and just going as fast as I can, and then my wife, Kathy, about 10 years ago, was diagnosed with breast cancer, and she was very sick for about a year through chemo and radiation. I only shot 2 pictures in case that was going to be it. I didn't want to torture her, because she doesn't like having her picture taken much. But as I was home for a year, I thought, well, I'm 43. What am I going to do to really move the needle? Is there anything a still photographer can do to really move the needle of public opinion, to get us to care about what's happening to the natural world? I thought about the work of John James Audubon, who was really a fine naturalist. He painted extinct birds, but also gave us great descriptions of what they were like. descriptions that we wouldn't know anything about these birds really if he hadn't been around. And I also thought about early photographers and early painters that documented Native Americans and the assault on their cultures as Europeans swept across America. And people like Catlin and Curtis who really devoted their lives to one focused thing. I thought, okay, instead of doing this, I'm gonna do this. Instead of being in the wild with the sea turtle, let's do this. Let's look these animals in the eye on very clean backgrounds, black and white backgrounds. This guy was slated to be made into stew that night in a bushmeat market in Equatorial Guinea. We bring black velvet with us and make him immortal. Let's do all this and call it the photo arc. And now it's National Geographic Photo Arc, thanks to Geographic sponsorship. Let's start doing this everywhere we can, as many times as I can, until the day I die. That's basically the plan, all right? So, amphibians is a story I kind of started out with once Kathy got to feeling better again, and I started venturing out. They're under tremendous assault now, climate change, pollution, and a fungus sweeping the world kills them off like crazy. A lot of frog species could be gone in the next 20 or 30 years. For those of you who think extinction is something that will happen in your grandchildren's time, I'm telling you it's happening right this second, right this minute actually. So what we do is we try to get people entertained. We really do. We want them to be entertained and we want them to be moved, but we can't scare them and we can't guilt them into caring about what happens. They'll just switch off. They have to be entertained. It has to compete with Kim Kardashian's rear end. It really does. So how do we convey to people though that this amphibian that's down to 9 in a lab in Ecuador, or this one down to 5, or 4, or 3, or this one even, the very last Rab's fringed limb tree frog, he sits by himself in a tank at the Atlanta Botanical Gardens. How do we convince people that this matters? Well, I don't know, but if you stand to lose half of an entire class of organisms in the next 20 or 30 years, and there aren't that many classes of animals, there's mammals and birds and reptiles and fish and amphibians. How do we get people to care? And I liken it to the fact that as this one's gone away, this is extinct now, this is very nearly so, and this is gone. I like to tell people the story. It's dramatic. Maybe this is entertaining. I don't know. The northern white rhino. In the Dvor Krilave Zoo last summer in June, we went and did portraits of her. She's very old, full of these cysts that they couldn't work on because she was too old to really anesthetize. She laid down and went to sleep at the end of the shoot. She died a week later. And now the world has 3. That's pretty dramatic. Is that enough to get people to care? Or if we go to the Suzhou Zoo in China, where they literally drain the pond to pull out this Yangtze giant softshell turtle. There's a male and a female out in the pond, but the problem is that the female, that's the only female in the world, the female was pulled out of a street market or a meat market by a circus owner for a sideshow as a full adult in 1920. Man, you just can't let it get down to the very last second before you try to bring species back. You really shouldn't. Very late in the game. It's like a Hail Mary pass. So what do? Do we frighten people? Well, no, maybe we show them good souls doing great work in a way that moves them or inspires them to want to follow suit. This is Don Butler in his backyard in these exquisitely kept aviaries. He and his wife, Ann, breed some of the rarest birds on Earth. This bird's extinct in the wild. He has 11% of the populations of Edwards pheasants in his backyard that he's breeding. And he's doing this knowing that he's never going to see these animals return to the wild. He is a caretaker. He's a finger in the dike. I love that. I love it when people do these things at great personal cost and sacrifice, knowing that the results of what they do, they'll never see come to fruition in their lifetimes in terms of letting the animals out again. They have to wait. They have to wait for people to get smarter and save habitat. Brian Gratwick of the Smithsonian set up a breeding center in Panama. He and his small crew are saving 5 or 6 species of amphibians from extinction. Thilo Nadler, a German expat, lives in Vietnam. He went there as an electronics repairman, and he saw all these baby primates being smuggled in and out of the country with no place to go if they were confiscated. He said, it was not what I did, but what could I do? There's no place to put these baby primates. Now his endangered primate rescue center in Cook Farm National Park houses 8 species of primate you can see nowhere else on Earth. This one's down to about 56 individuals, actually, the catbalanger. Amazing and grand in its own way. And so what do? Well, I don't know. I think that perhaps the solution is direct eye contact with animals that maybe we can relate to. Maybe we think they're like us. Maybe they're anthropomorphic. Those seem to really register well when we put them out on the Geographic's Instagram site. Maybe it's strength or an animal that you grew up loving. Maybe it's just weird stuff. What will it take to get people to care about the fact that as we lose each species, it's a little bit like, let's think of yourself on a flight over here to Zurich, and you're on an airplane made of thousands of rivets, hundreds of thousands of rivets. With the loss of each species, it's a rivet coming out of the wing. How many are you comfortable losing and you still want to sit on that flight? I'm not comfortable losing any of them. And I have a feeling that as we go along in time, if humanity makes it forward in time another 100 or 200 years, that we will really start to realize that this is not only kind of tragic to lose species to extinction, but it's also epic. And it led to real problems with us. It's not just the species, it's the habitat. We have to save rainforests around the world to regulate our climate. There's lots of different reasons to want to save species. And it all boils down to this for me. What happens to them could happen to us. 50% of all species now threatened with extinction by 2100. That's a big deal. It's folly to think we can doom half of them and not have it really affect our way of life. And it's coming. And I'm a witness for you. I'm just standing here with my arms waving saying there's a little bit of a bridge out. We do these portraits, by the way. We've been around the world to zoos, and they now know of the work, and they let me paint off exhibit spaces, and we load in a bison. Or go to the Suzhou Zoo's South China Tiger Breeding Center, they let me paint the wall black, although they mixed a little red in the paint for better luck for some reason. And then this is what the eye sees, and this is what it looks like when we crank up the shutter speed and make it darker. A little bit of light, throw a little bit more in. This is how we do the portraits, just like for something we can't handle. If it's something smaller, oftentimes we'll put them in a little shooting tent. And the animals, they like it okay sometimes. They help me edit, I guess. Sometimes they're very shy. Sometimes they really don't like the bright lights or the attention. Although this primate was eating bananas in between doing this, so I think he was doing okay. These mice were planning their escape from my shooting tent. They didn't get out. Not until we were done. And this will show you a shoot that's gone a little bit wrong, but actually this has happened quite a bit. I just happened to have a WGBH film crew with me this day. Ooh. Yeah. Not bashful bird. Not a bashful bird at all. Ow! Ooh. Oh, crap. Oh man, this is one of those birds that's gonna try to blind me.
Ash, I was asking about your lens.
Yeah, okay. Here we go. This is gonna be one of those things where I'm back here. Em, can you distract him in the back of the box?
Raja. Raja.
Oh, you did that. Yikes, you scared.
Ow!
Give me some break.
God dang it. Man, can he bite? Can he bite? Holy cow.
Yeah, look at how big and bad he is.
Oh my god. God dang it.
Here we go, Red.
This is like a $6,000 camera. Doesn't he know that?
Hey.
Ow! God dang it. Do you like this bird, Jen?
Yes, he's fantastic. Raja! Raja! Look at his beautiful eyelashes. Yes, he is glorious.
Got it. Nice. Okay. I'm kind of glad they got that footage. We've gotten a lot of mileage out of that footage, you know? I mean, really, these things are all works of art. You know, to me, we stand guard over these great works of art in museums, right? And yet, we have these things that are so exquisitely crafted over millions of years, just beautiful. To me, these are worth more than any work of art you could ever see, and yet, we're throwing them away. So what do we do? This is the big question of our time. How do we get people to turn around? How do we get them to care about these amazing things we share the planet with? Boils down to what I mentioned earlier. It's got to be entertaining. That's it. It's got to be fascinating. It's got to be entertaining. We've got to show this to children young. Just sticking to small little screens, pressed against screens in your parents' basement, you're getting all your information that way? No, we got to get them into the tent of conservation. That means getting them excited, getting them out into the world, letting them get muddy once in a while, taking them to zoos. Actually, zoos are a really good place. They're all the good ones, right? The accredited zoos. They all do captive breeding now of critically endangered species, and there's nothing like seeing and smelling and even touching an educational animal that's taken to schools. That is a really powerful thing. That's a huge deal, really is. Primates I'm especially attracted to because they really register with the public. They're as anthropomorphic as you can possibly get. Now you notice in all these cases, we're not seeing many chimps here, are we? Well, here's why you're not seeing any chimps today. What do you think? So we're pretty good?
All you can do is hope.
They're pretty strong. I hear they could rip your arm off and beat you to death with it, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, pretty much.
So now, doesn't this look nice? Doesn't this look nice? Perfect. It's perfect for chimps. How long will that last? 60 seconds? We don't use paper anymore. We use paint if we have to do apes, but chimps are really smart. The good news is, and the reason I believe this type of tactic could work, being entertaining, is that when an animal's been cute enough or powerful enough in a way, we've saved them when we knew there was trouble. I think there's great capacity in people to want to save things they know are in trouble. Look at how the world responds, hopefully, to the refugee crisis. I mean, the whooping crane, the California condor, the Mexican gray wolf, all these animals got down to fewer than 24, and they're stable by now just because people cared. A handful of people cared about these animals and wanted to save them. That's good. So to get the message out and to keep animals and extinction on the forefront and keep it entertaining by all means, we're doing all sorts of stuff with these pictures. First of all, we give every picture away to every zoo, aquarium, private breeder, wildlife rehabber I work with. We give them all away. National Geographic runs them quite a lot. They're used in anti-palm oil campaigns. They're used on zoo websites, anti-extinction campaigns on trolley cars in Melbourne. You name it, they're being used all over the place, anti-ivory campaigns, and that's good. We want the pictures to go to work. But something's happening recently that finally, at almost 6,000 species in 10 years, I figure I'll go 25 years, that'll be about when I'm dead, and I'll probably get most of what the world has in captivity. This come along, which is quite interesting. Lifting, in a way, entertaining for sure, and there's gonna be more projections where these come from. These were done by Luis Cihoyos, who did the movie Racing Extinction. And he asked for pictures, and we gave them to him.
In 200 years, people will look back on this particular period and say to themselves, how did those people at that time just allow all these amazing creatures to vanish? But it would be very little use in me or anybody else exerting all this energy to save the wild places if people are not being educated into being better stewards than we've been. If we all lose hope, there is no hope. Without hope, people fall into apathy. There's still a lot left that's worth fighting for.
So let me get a show of hands. How many of you had heard of these projections, that had heard animals were on the Vatican? How many people? A few. So we're moving the needle a little bit, and we're going to keep going until Kim Kardashian's butt gets nervous. We're going to make a run at that butt, in a way. You know, I guess to sum up, I would just ask you guys this. As you look at these animals, and they're animals many of you have known since childhood, do you care? If you care, believe it or not, it's pretty easy to get involved in saving species. Whether or not you make decisions on a corporate level in terms of how to extract resources from the earth, how to recycle, how to be more energy efficient, That directly impacts species. Sure, becoming a member of your local zoo, where they breed captive species, is a great start. Educating your children is a great start too, but we really can't wait for the next generation to start tackling this. We actually have to look at it right now, right this very second. So think about how you spend your money, whether it's your money or the money you're responsible for. Every dollar has the potential to do great harm, but it also has the potential to do great good. So I just ask you to think. This stuff's complicated, it doesn't happen overnight, but you know what? I think if we get enough people on board, we can make a real difference. Thanks a lot, folks.